Today, as we celebrate the feast of sorrow of Mary, it really is a feast that kind of causes a question in our minds. You know, how is it that we in some way honor Mary because of her sorrow? At first glance, it seems like a very awkward title, being sad, sorrowful, gloomy, or depressed. All the ways that we think about being sorrowful seems a very odd thing to be focusing on today. There's no question, obviously, that Mary experienced enormous sorrow. Certainly the worst day of her life had to be the day when she stood at the foot of her son's cross, and as she saw his breath leaving him, hearing his last words, "Woman, behold your son, behold your mother." It must have been traumatic for Mary. We can almost experience the pain, the sorrow that must have been in her heart at that moment. Honoring Mary as Our Lady of Sorrows because of the great sorrow that she has endured almost seems, though, like a contradiction, or it seems like misplaced piety. But of course, the opposite is true. And it's true because what it does is it focuses our attention on that event 2,000 years ago when Jesus died on the cross. Yesterday was the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross. And as we hear those words, why do we exalt the cross? That also seems like a poor use of words. In what sense are we exalting the cross? The cross, of course, was an instrument of torture. It was an instrument of death. Why do we talk about the exaltation of the cross? And of course, the answer to that probably comes to us from John's Gospel. In the Gospel yesterday, the Feast of the Exaltation of the Cross, Jesus is talking with Nicodemus, and he says that unless we are able to reflect upon what Moses did in the desert, Moses lifted up a bronze serpent, and unless we're able to do what Moses did, then somehow we're not appreciating what it is that takes place when Jesus is lifted up. I think what it specifically says is, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the desert, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. You see, what happened in the desert, because of their unfaithfulness, seraph serpents were sent, and they were biting people and killing people. And Moses prayed to God, and God said, well, put a bronze serpent on a stick and hold it high. And when people look upon the bronze serpent, they will be healed. And of course, that's exactly what happened. And so as Jesus invites Nicodemus to reflect upon that, he's reflecting upon the fact that the Son of Man is also going to be lifted up. And as we are lifted up, as the Son of Man is lifted up, and we gaze upon Jesus and his cross, we're also healed as well, not because of the death of Jesus, but because of what the death enables. You see, there's no resurrection, there's no Easter Sunday, unless there is first a Good Friday. And so the reminder of death, the cross, the instrument of torture, really becomes for us the symbol of life, the symbol of new life, of what Jesus has accomplished for us by his life, his death, and his resurrection. Karl Rahner once upon a time said that we really have to become mystics in the way in which we live out our gift of faith. And in a very real way, the cross invites us to engage in that sense of mystical theology, to reflect upon the cross as an instrument of torture, but yet the cross becomes the instrument of new life. It becomes the instrument in which we're able to experience the full breadth and depth of God's love, the way in which God is able to bring life out of death, the way God is able to bring joy out of sorrow and sadness. And of course, as we think about that today, we begin now to come back to the way in which we celebrate the sorrow of our Blessed Lady. We do so because her sorrow is not the end of the story. What happens on Easter Sunday is really what happens that gives us a sense of hope. Mary's sorrow ends in the joy of the resurrection. I think it was St. Ignatius who first wondered out loud whether or not the first person to whom Jesus appeared after his resurrection was probably his mother. There's no scriptural foundation for that, but as we think about that in a kind of a common sense way, wouldn't that be what Jesus would do? Thinking about the great sorrow that his mother experienced, wouldn't Jesus probably have appeared to Mary first? Don't know if that's true, but it certainly is a plausible thing. Mary today, as we think about the Feast of Our Lady of Sorrows, really becomes a reminder to us of the hope that is at the heart and core of our faith. As people of faith, we know that our hope always tells us that the glass is never half empty, it's always half full. Whatever sorrows we have, whatever difficulties we experience in life, we bring those to the cross of Christ. We unite our sufferings, our sorrows, to Christ's sufferings. And we know that the suffering, the sadness that we experience in life is not the end of the story. Great saint once upon a time said that in the end all will be well. And a good friend of mine at the end of his emails always puts a little rejoinder to that. He says, if things are not well, then it's not the end. I love that because it really reminds us about the gift of the faith that we have and the way in which that gift of faith becomes a prism for us to deal with all of life. We know that there is great suffering in the world. We sometimes experience that great suffering in our own lives. We bring that suffering to Christ. We bring that sorrow to the cross. And in that whole process, as we reflect upon the cross, the way in which Jesus was lifted up for us, we ultimately find consolation. We find healing. We open ourselves up to experience the incredible grace and power of God's presence in our lives and ultimately experience that sense of hope that tells us that death is not the end, that the new life that Christ has created us for awaits on the other side of the grave, and that even in life today, there are great, great sorrows, but as we pray, we ultimately experience the grace of God that enables us to deal with suffering and sorrow and pain. All that, I think, is part of what the Church invites us to think about today as we celebrate Mass honoring our Blessed Lady. She truly has this unique place in all of the history of salvation. We sometimes overuse that word, but absolutely, it's completely and totally accurate when we think of our Blessed Lady. She is unique because of her yes to God, because of the way in which she, with her divine Son, helps us to understand how we live through life, how we deal with suffering, how we ultimately are filled with a sense of hope that tells us about the resurrection and about what God has promised for us in the future.